Good morning, everybody. Neil, are we ready to get started?
Ready to go.
All right. Good morning, everybody. This is Allison Dvorak with Grimco's hardware software team. We wanted to thank you all for your time this morning. We truly do value your time and your business. I wanted to take a quick minute before we get started to give you a little bit of background on Grimco. Grimco was started in 1875 as a stamp and badge company. We currently have over 50 locations in the U.S. and 7 in Canada. We have a wide variety of offerings of supplies as well as equipment. If you haven't already, I encourage you all to take some time and look at our website to learn more about who we are. In this session, we're going to be covering the HP Latex printer. We're going to spend about 45 minutes talking about the printer, and then with the end for about 15 minutes, we're going to open up to a question and answer session. In the chat box of the Zoom software is going to be where we're going to enter our questions for the Q&A. Feel free during the presentation to do it. We have Missy McGrath on from HP that's going to help us monitor the questions and also start off the Q&A with maybe a couple other things that she has to add to the presentation. So anything that you have, go ahead and fill it out in the chat section and we will address it at the end. At this time, we're going to turn it over to Neil.
Thank you, Allison. Welcome. Good morning, everybody. My name is Neil McNamara. I'm broadcasting here from the Chicago Demo Center. We got a 5,000 square foot room here that houses and showcases one piece of all the hardware equipment that Grimco has to offer. Before I delve into the HP Latex 360, I want to take a minute to share my story and tell you about myself. So I worked for a print shop for many, many years that had a great, long-lasting relationship with Grimco. It was phenomenal to work with all the Grimco sales reps, the technicians on a day-to-day basis, get all the supplies, media, things that we needed. In addition to always relying on Grimco for any time we were going to upgrade the technology, the hardware, software within our shop. So after many years, I just decided to part ways with that company. Was doing some other things within our industry, but then I got wind of Grimco opening up this demo center and was fortunate enough to be able to take on the role as a technician and operate inside this demo center on a day-to-day basis. It's been a phenomenal experience. So in addition to this 5,000 square foot demo center, which is incredible, the other side of this wall, just outside this window here, you can see we have a 100,000 square foot distribution facility stacked floor to ceiling with every type of digital media, rigid substrate, inks, tools, anything you can imagine the Grimco could supply our customers with to perform their business on a day-to-day pace. So let's go ahead and dig right into the HP Latex 365 that I have sitting right in front of me. With having just shared my history with you guys, I want to preface this whole thing, letting you know that this isn't a polished sales pitch by any stretch of the imagination. I'm a technician, operator, production guy. So I'm going to show you how this machine works, take it through its paces. Of course, I'm going to share with you some of the great features that make this machine stand out in the industry. But if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to your local Grimco rep. Like Allison said, go ahead and hit your questions down in the chat. If there's something I'm not touching on, you got a question about, go ahead and fire away. Missy and Allison should be able to help answer those questions as we go along. So without any further ado, let me go ahead and jump into it. I know you guys tuned in because you want to see this machine print. So I'm going to go ahead and load a roll of media on here. There we are. So this is just a self-adhesive vinyl, bright lines, 32. This nice lit up area inside my carriage. That's not an OEM spec. Ben from our office here is the Hanley LED expert, and he retrofitted this machine with these LEDs. It makes it a little more photogenic, I hope, on camera. It also does an amazing job when we're printing backlit. That LED really makes that backlit image pop right here. Kind of a cool feature, but not a standard feature on the machine. So I went ahead and fed the material through here. The machine recognized, I don't know if you were able to hear the beep that it made on the inside. Machine recognized, hey, there's a substrate in here, and I need to tell it what substrate that is. So I'm going to take it through my load configuration. What I'm doing now is an automatic load process. There's a manual process you can go through, too, if you're dealing with a trickier substrate, say like a fabric or a scrim banner or something like that. So then I go to my substrate library. And I'm going to choose a preloaded preset. Like I said, this is that 3201. I've printed rolls and rolls and rolls of this material on this machine. Got a bunch of different print modes. I'm going to go ahead and select that substrate, hit continue. And now the machine's going to go through its automatic loading process. It's going to advance the substrate out a little bit. It's going to move that print head carriage back and forth, find the width. One of the key things that it's doing right now, too, is checking the skew. So you can see it's spinning the material forward. It's taking a reading of that edge, drawing the material back, taking a reading of that edge again. The reason that's so important, I want to run this entire 150-foot roll here. And if my material is too skewed, by the time I get down to the end of that roll, it's going to run off, start running, my print's going to start running off. And so it came up and said, hey, your skew is 146.7 mils per inch. If I was going to run this entire roll, which this demo is not long enough to do that, it probably takes about 2 hours or so, I would do some adjustments to fix that skew. But I'm only going to run a decent amount, maybe 7 feet of the material, 8 feet of the material. So I'm going to go ahead and accept that skew and move on with this demonstration. So here we go. Lift the lever, drop it down, and it's going to go through that check substrate process. It's nice that it's not relying on my eyeballs to say, oh, yeah, no, this thing's pretty straight. It's going to run good. The machine's going to allow it or accept it based on the parameters you have set for your media. This is an important aspect. One of the really great things that this machine does is printing double-sided. So to get great registration from one side to the next, it's important that that media is not skewed one way or the other when you're printing. So if you really tighten up those parameters of skew, you get perfect vertical registration on a banner or a mounting film substrate. So let me tell you a little bit about the HP ink that we're printing with. HP ink is the exclusive manufacturer of HP inks, of latex inks. Sorry, misspoke there. Latex ink is unique. It's a water-based ink system, which means many, many things. It makes it some unique properties, but probably the most important aspect is it is environmentally friendly. Okay, I like to think that every banner, sign, wall graphic, window graphic that I've ever produced is going to stay up for eternity. And once it served its purpose, if it had a date on there, it's going to be enshrined in a museum somewhere. That's the reality of it is that it will eventually wind up in a landfill after it's had its nice service life a long many years. I could sleep well at night knowing that we're not polluting a landfill with my old banners and signs that I've produced over the years. Additionally, the latex ink properties, I'm going to go ahead and jump over here and hit print real fast. Here we are. The properties of the latex ink don't stop with environmental friendly. It gives you incredible color gamut with the machine. So this is a 6-color machine, CMYK, light magenta, light cyan. Checking out my RIP software. Everything's going great. Okay. First print I've ran of the day. So CMYK, light cyan, light magenta. So it gives you an incredible color gamut, but they also added one additional channel in there, and it's a channel called Optimizer. And what Optimizer is, it's a positively charged particle that is dropped down ahead of your color channels that allows the ink to be basically drawn to that place and stay in place until it goes across the heating platen. So this leading edge of the machine right in here is an induction oven for all intents and purposes. The ink drops out, and I'll zoom in here and see if I can get you a little better shot of what's going on here. Ink drops out as the carriage goes back and forth. There's no heat brought into the printing zone. And that's the latest benefit of this generation of latex printers. The first generation or so, second generation of latex printers, they had to induce heat early on or introduce heat early on to get that ink to stay where the ink head drops it out or the print heads drop it out onto the substrate. With the addition of that optimizer layer, that optimizer channel, the optimizer holds that ink droplet until that material, until that ink moves forward through the platen and then is permanently set and locked into place by removing all the water that's just suspending the pigment inside there. So we have the Latex 365 in front of us here. HP makes other versions in this model range of their roll-to-roll latex. They have a 335, a 315, and a 115. And then a step up from here would be the 560, the 570. Let me go up first, and then I'll work my way back down. The 560, 570 have a slightly revised curing zone inside here. It's more of an enclosed. You see, I have about an inch and a half gap here. I got an array of fans going across the front, so it's drawing air into the curing chamber, into the drying chamber inside here. The 560, 570 have a more enclosed. It's maybe a quarter inch gap inside there. When it leaves the curing zone, everything kind of stays contained. To achieve that, they had to add a condensation tank, which is constantly drawing that wet moisture, that optimizer, the water from the water-based sinks, drawing that extra moisture out of there and collecting it down into a condensation tank. Additionally, the 570 series offers a bulk load. All of the HP Latex machines, the lower series, 365, 560, 570, all use a 775 milliliter cartridge of ink. Later on in the demonstration, I'm going to show you how easy it is to change these inks. The 570 series uses a 3-liter box of ink in addition to a 775 cartridge as a bulk tank that constantly is feeding the intermediate tank, which is then feeding the machine. Really, really great system, Presser Platin. So now let's take a step down and look at what the 335, 315, and 115 have. The 335 has all of the same great features of the 365 that we're looking at. They put a smaller touchscreen on here. So this is an 8-inch touchscreen. The 315, 115, 335 all have the 4-inch touchscreen, but it still has the same take-up reel. Now the 315, same features. It has an optional take-up reel. It doesn't come standard with a take-up reel. So if you are constantly doing short runs, not laminating, just doing poster prints, 2x3s, some small, and you're not worried about material kind of coming out on your floor, take-up reel is not really necessary. 115, exact same process, no optional take-up reel, but it is a 54-inch wide. I'm sorry, the 335 and the 315 are 54-inch wide. Every other series, 335 and up, is a 64-inch wide. I'm only printing on 54-inch self-adhesive right now, but this can print up to a 63-inch wide banner. All right, so we got a print coming off the machine. Here's the part I've been saving about latex ink that makes it far beyond the best ink set or best designed ink set out there. As soon as this print comes off the printer, it is dry and ready to go. It is fully cured. It is optimally set up right now. I literally could take this print and use it for the application. So if I had a vehicle in here that I needed to wrap later this afternoon, this print's ready to go. Run it through my laminator, slap it on the vehicle. We are in business. We are good to go. I don't know how things are in your guys' shop, but I know in my shop days, it seems like every job was a last minute. We need this right now. The HP Latex allows you to fulfill those commitments quite easily. It's a game changer as far as workflow and being able to increase your throughput. So this ink, completely scratch resistant. It's a baked on layer of ink put on top of the substrate. Makes it great for a lot of different purposes where you would normally have to laminate. I will admit it, I am probably not the best at laminating. I don't know if it's my beard hairs that always wind up in things or my sausage fingers and I can't get the lambda to line up straight and I take a long time. With the latex inks, you don't need to laminate. It has a 3-year expected outdoor durability. So you print a banner today, hang it on a fence, 3 years from now, that color of that ink is gonna look amazing. I highly recommend you use a good quality banner because the substrate, the material itself, will start to degrade before the quality of the ink will start to degrade. The ink quality, the ink staying power is so good on this machine that 3M has offered, is certified to a 7-year MCIS warranty on vehicle wraps. And they've also certified the HP Latex 365 in conjunction with the Flexi software for regulated traffic signs. Running that software, hitting a prescribed color, and then running it through a laminating process on the diamond grade reflective. We'll see how well this shows up on camera. There we go. Oh, that comes out very nice. So, a 10-year warranty for regulated traffic signage. That's a testament to the power of the latex ink. Really, really incredible material. So let's go ahead and it's just about finished with the print. I'm going to jump over here real quick and show you how easy it is to use the online systems that HP has developed. HP has a system called Print OS. It's a cloud-based application tool that allows this machine to communicate and give you real-time feedback on ways to improve your productivity, some cost accounting features. There's also an online media locator. There's a lot of great tools already exist with the Print OS system. And if I know HP, they're probably not done with that process. They're going to constantly add some features and things as it goes along. It's been in development for many, many years, and it keeps getting better and better every day. One of the neatest features is the Latex mobile app on your phone. Say you wanted to take a long lunch, but you got a rush job that has to get out. You can download a mobile app on your phone, and it'll give you real-time feedback on what's going on with your machine. I got a really large run of job, and I want to, I don't want to come back to the shop until it's ran. I can see what, okay, oh, we got about 20 minutes left on that job. I could have another cookie after I have my sandwich. Or you want to run unattended overnight. You're pretty sure you loaded up with ink before you hit print on that last job, which is going to take the entire roll of material. You get home and you start thinking about it. You can quickly pull it up on your app and be like, oh, yeah, no, I got plenty of cyan ink in there. We're good to go. It's going to be no problem at all. This scenario comes up all the time. Like I said, we have a 100,000 square foot warehouse out here. I'll be running a job and I wasn't thinking about how much ink was in there, and I'll get an alert on my phone saying, hey, your yellow ink just ran out. I have about 10 minutes to get back over here and put in a new cartridge, swap it out on the fly, and that machine will pick right up and start printing where it left off. After, I believe the number is 10 minutes. Missy might be able to answer that question better for me. I think she has one of these machines in her living room. So after about 10 minutes, it'll automatically cancel the job because that ink is sitting here in the print zone, the laydown ink. It's sitting here in the print zone. It hasn't cured properly. So when it starts up printing again and then everything cures, you're going to see a color difference from where that ink cartridge left off to where it didn't. As long as you hit it within that 10-minute window time, you wouldn't even notice that you had an ink change in the middle of it. So I'm going to jump over here real quick to the online library and pull up the different medias. One of the great things about the HP Latex 365 is you can print on a wide variety of media. So you can print on fabric. You can print on linerless mesh if you have the inkwell collectors. I'll show you those that item in a little bit here. Fabric, obviously self-adhesive vinyls, a wide variety of it. I showed you the diamond grade reflective material used for signage. It's a real thick 14 mil, 16 mil. It's a real thick media in there. Speaking of thick medias, Magnum Magnetics makes a really nice magnet that is latex compatible. The head of this can accommodate, I believe the spec is 020. The Magnum Magnetics Digimag is 015, and so it runs through the HP Latex with no problem whatsoever. So I got my online library pulled up here. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen with you guys and show you some of the cool features that are available through that. Okay, let's jog over here. All right, so this is just showing you the embedded web server that HP offers. So this is the IP address of my printer that I'm running right now, and it gives you some good features. You can see where my ink levels are. I wasn't kidding when I say I like to run my ink pretty low all the time, but that's the beauty of it. I mean, the system's so intuitive to be able to know when you got to change inks. And so this is, let me jump right over here and clear my screen out. Okay, there we go. So there, we're jumping to here. Let me hit a refresh. That was something I was looking at earlier. I'll show you that one in a minute as a preview of what's to come. But here's the online media locator that's available from the front panel of my machine. So at the touch of a button at the machine, I'm able to access 1,074 already created profiles for all the different medias. You could search by brand on here and check out 3M, check out Avery. What I'm going to go ahead and type in here is Grimco, and this will give you access to all of the already uploaded, already set profiles for all the different Grimco medias that you might want to print on. Okay, now this is all well and good, but say you've used them and you've had some great print results and you want to do a little modification. There's a really cool way to go ahead and create your own profiles using this machine. So the Latex 365, 560, and 570 have an onboard I1 reader built into the carriage of the machine that allows you to create your own profiles very easily. So I'm going to hit new self-adhesive vinyl. And that's going to give me an option of choosing an ICC profile or a generic properties for right now. So I'm going to choose just generic self-adhesive. Sorry for the refresh taking some time, but okay. And now the machine is going to walk me through the steps needed to be able to create my own customized, nobody else in the world has this profile for the media that I got loaded in here. So say I want to do something really unique with this Brightline 3201. I want to try to put down the deepest, richest colors I can come up with. Or say I want to go the other direction and I want to produce a profile that just prints it as fast as humanly possible. But at the same time, I still want to maintain good color and good print quality. Using this three-step process, the first one is going to lay down a test swatch of different ink level saturations. And then allow me to adjust my heat settings on my machine to make sure at that setting, that number of passes, the machine's going to produce the ink that lay down the right level ink to dry and give me a good, nice print quality. The second step is going to do a color calibration. I'm going to talk more about that in just a second. And then the third step, literally at the push of a button, that onboard I1 spectrophotometer is going to run through, print all those swatches, run through, and then read those swatches accurately and give me a custom created ICC profile based on this media and this machine. And it's going to be able to allow me to accurately hit Pantone colors within the range, the color gamut of this machine. So really kind of cool feature. You don't need to be a Mensa candidate to be able to walk through those steps and to create a custom media profile for this exact machine on the exact media that you want to print on to achieve the results you want. So I talked about the color calibration step and that media creation profile. With that onboard photospectrometer, the HP Latex inks, HP has designed a closed loop color system, okay? I'm printing on this 3201 today. I can see from my front panel, the media guide is telling me, hey, this media is in calibration. It's good to go. So if I was to run a print on this today, some amazing sign, a wall graphic, window graphic, because I'm in calibration today, 6 months from now, a year from now, customer comes back and say, hey, I'd really like, I got a new store opening up and you guys did a phenomenal job installing my window graphics last time. I need you to produce that exact same stuff for my new store. Great, no problem. I can confidently know that if I print with that same color profile I used today, it was in color calibration when I used it today, when I load it the next time, make sure it's in color calibration, and this machine is going to produce those results, those exact same color results over and over again. So maintaining that closed loop color system, it's specific for this machine, developed in with that color profile, but it gives you those tools, it gives you that ability to be more consistent without a hassle of having to, offline I1's photospectrometers, dialing all things in. It allows you to really quickly and easily dial in your color and be more consistent with your color over the length of the machine. So let me jump right into showing you how to change an ink cartridge. Again, everything kind of starts and ends from the front panel. So I'm going to click on my little my icon for my inks. I'm going to hit replace inks. It's going to tell me it's preparing for ink cartridge replacement. If this machine was printing right now, say I wanted to run a long job and I wanted to make sure I got a full cartridge in there, it'll allow me to change that ink while it's printing. It just takes a minute or two longer for the print to pause. The whole system kind of has to depressurize. Everything happens in here under a pressure vacuum system. Here's my ink cartridge up close and personal. They're all custom. So this is light cyan or light magenta, sorry. They all have individual, let's see if I can get a good angle on that one, individual notches on there. So you could not replace this in the wrong slot unless you pushed really hard. Maybe a hammer would need to be involved, but it can't be done. So, but you can see there's two valves in here. One is for out, one is for in. And that's how it keeps, that's how it pressurizes the entire system and gets the ink flowing through. So I'm gonna go ahead and swap out this light magenta. That one's not completely empty, so I'm gonna put it up there. I'll put it in there, put it back in later when I know I'm gonna watch this machine printing, so I can be here to swap it out. And we hit okay. It's gonna go through it, reads the chip on the ink cartridge, recognizing it's the right ink in the right location, and now it tells me exactly how much is in there. So really easy system to work through. While I got the machine turned off, I want to show you something else. One of the beauty of the HP Latex 365, the entire line, is the ease of maintenance. Okay, they really designed some, it's user-friendly. It's, I don't have to spend my day, you know, pulling out solvents and wiping things here and there. It's kind of an all self-contained system. There are some periodic things that you do with your machine to kind of keep it running. One of which is opening this up here, cleaning your, obviously you're going to initiate this through the front panel because it is a time-based system. The machine knows when these maintenance things need to be taken care of. But you're cleaning your encoder strip. You get in here, wipe down the encoder strip. Cleaning and lubing the guide rails that are on here. It's a quick little isopropanol. It runs across, or some alcohol-based cleaner to clean that off. And then they provide you with the oil that needs to go on the rails. And that's a cycle-based maintenance thing that pops up every once in a while. But the part that makes it the easiest to clean is this maintenance cartridge. I'm going to go ahead and pull this one out of here and show you some of the neat features of that. So again, initiate it. Now it's telling me go ahead and open the maintenance cartridge door. And I'm going to pull this cartridge out and we'll take a look at it. I'm going to switch over to another camera angle and see if this one works a little better for you. Get a little close-up view of things here. So here is my maintenance cartridge. It's got a nice wiper tissue box that kind of rotates around and keeps a nice clean wipe on here. Two rollers as the print heads go across with a wiper blade. And then you got a nice capping station. You see how that wiper blade set at a 45-degree angle? This way you're not hitting your print heads dead on. It's offset so that it does a nice job wiping those heads off there. This is the only waste tank for this machine. It's not constantly purging ink into a separate container that needs to be disposed of later. Water-based ink, it's not going to dry up on me unless it comes over under extreme heat. I say extreme, like that's a bad word. A few hundred degrees of heat. I think it can cure as low as about 140. It doesn't get that hot inside this demo center, fortunately. So long as that ink doesn't come under that heat temperature, it's going to stay viable and liquid, and it's not going to cure. So there's no waste ink because the machine doesn't need to constantly be spitting out ink into to keep the nozzles fresh. So again, this is a user serviceable piece. It's open up the box, take the packaging out, insert it in your machine. And it will allow the machine to keep doing its own maintenance on a regular basis. All right, so it's telling me, hey, this isn't a new one. Are you sure you don't want to replace it? I'm going to say no, but keep using it. Again, if we could switch back to the IP address, I could show you. Let me jog over here. There we are. And so this even gives me a status of my maintenance cartridge, status of my print heads, everything's okay, status of my maintenance cartridge, here's my ink, and your curing temperature. Now, this is the temperature of what my machine is. When I'm printing the machine, I believe this 3201 is somewhere in the 220 to 230 range of printing. So all that information is available in the print OS as well as the front panel of the machine. So I want to show you guys another cool feature of this machine. It's got a built-in cutter. Go ahead and hit the scissor option. It's gonna advance my media forward a little bit. I do a nice little cut. So I'm gonna go ahead and move these over to my plotter. I got several to choose from here. Grimco offers many, many plotters. HP offers this, Sorry, there we go. Set this guy down. HP offers a print and cut bundle for several of their machines. There's a package available with the print and cut bundle that gives you one of the machines. The print and cut bundle comes in a couple different options. Your sales rep can help you out figuring that out. Software to run the whole program. It's a Flexi software, which has some design attributes built into it as well, and then the HP Latex cutter. We also carry the HP Latex cutter is a Summa cutter, rebranded, repackaged for HP. We also offer other models of the Summa cutters, as well as GraphTech cutters. Again, it's one of those things your sales rep can help you kind of work through, figure out what is best for your workflow. And when speaking of workflow, it really comes down to software. Flexi is a great, robust, open source software program that operates as a rip, a nice cutting feature. It has some nice design elements in it too. Onyx is a very nice workflow software. Allows you to kind of really dial in color. And when you talk about dialing in color, Caldera is also a great option to really kind of tweak it. Caldera is a great option for those of us who are Mac users and want to be able to run that operating system. Everything else is a Windows-based software system. So let's come back over here, and I want to show you a couple of the neat things. I'm going to advance this material just a little bit and get another print running for you. So I'm advancing this media just a little bit outside the print zone, the drying curing zone. This zone right in here, the leading 10 inches or so of this machine, it gets warm. That's where all the curing takes place. So by having the leading edge of my material just outside of my machine, I can guarantee myself this is going to run straight and true and not have any head strike issues. So I'm going to go ahead and get a print running, and then I'm going to take you over and show you some other neat features on this machine. Go find the correct file, and we're going to go in and hit print. All right, so let me go ahead and switch over my camera view again so I can show you some other things going on with this machine. So this is the meat and potatoes that makes the entire system run. The HP Latex has a user serviceable printhead built into it. The printhead and the ink, that's the key to the entire system. I am guilty of it, just like I'm really poor at laminating things. Not really poor, just not the greatest. I am guilty of causing head strikes on my machine. It's generally because I hit a print, I walk away, I go grab a cup of coffee, I'm not paying attention, and sure enough, I turn around, oh man, that's a disaster. With a built-in printhead system that's tied into part of the printhead, that's a major problem. It's going to be a service call. You have to have a tech come out. It's several thousand dollars to get that remedy, to get that fixed, all just because of a little carelessness and not paying attention, trying to do too much at once. That's usually what I'm guilty of. With HP Latex, you're able to replace the print heads in a matter of minutes, be up and running. So in the unlikely event that something happens and you didn't pay attention and there's a head crash, or you know, the print head just degrades over time. HP is very upfront about the fact that all printheads will fail at some point. It may be 10 years from now, 5 years from now, whenever, but at some point a printhead is going to have an issue. With their system, you're able to replace that and remedy that issue yourself. There's no waiting, there's no downtime. Something's going on and nozzles are clogged beyond any recognition. You've tried there's some remedial actions you could take to recover that printhead. It's just not happening. It's a simple matter of pulling one out of the box. You know, it's a good idea to always have a couple extras, or at least one extra of each printhead on hand. Fairly inexpensive item as opposed to an embedded, you know, $1,000 system. It's a simple matter walking through the front panel, say, hey, replace this yellow and magenta printhead. Boom, boom, takes through. The machine goes through an automatic printhead alignment process, and you're back in printing within a matter of minutes. Really, really ingenious system to allow these machines to maintain their color accuracy and color productivity. No one wants to spend hours and hours and hours trying to remedy a printhead problem. We've all been there. It's not a lot of fun with the HP Latex system. It becomes a moot point. So one of the other cool accessories I wanted to show and share with you guys is the fabric loading assist. So like I said, HP Latex, super versatile. You can print on a huge variety of medias and substrates. It's just challenging to get it loaded sometimes. It's fabric, so it's real soft, you know, it's flexible, pliable, you know, it doesn't feed into that webbing there. This has magnets built into these plastic straps here. You lay down your fabric edge in here, slap your magnets down, and then this is going to allow you a nice rigid leading edge to feed up into your machine. Really, really great accessory for adding on here. I had mentioned it earlier about being able to replace the platens. So the 365, 560, 570, you can pull out the existing platens that are in there and replace it with this inkwell collector platen. So if you were printing on a porous fabric, a linerless mesh, Duratex makes a really nice linerless mesh banner. You can print this entire banner. The ink goes right through the mesh, collects inside this inkwell here. You can see mine are a little little funky and dirty. I've ran a couple of rolls of that Duratex mesh. Just love the way it looks, and super easy to finish. It comes right off the machine. It's already dry. I literally take it to my cutter table, slice it all up. You can throw a hem on there, and now you get a complete finished banner, scratch resistant, 3-year outdoor durability. It's a phenomenal solution. But with these inkwell collectors, it allows you not to have to then peel a liner off of a mesh product before you can use it. Really nice. Let's see what else I got here. These are unique, fairly simple, but they are ingenious in their design. So this is what's called a platen protector. So like I said, the platen on this machine, it's a stainless steel platen, gets very, very hot. If you were running a scrim banner that had a real smooth face to it, so it's a vinyl banner, when that banner gets heated up, it's going to get a little tacky, a little sticky, which could cause your material to kind of jump as it's trying to move through the platen. With these platen protectors, it's going to create basically an airspace that it just glides nice and smooth across that platen. The HP Latex 365 has an OMOS system. It's Optical Media Advanced Sensor. Hope I got that acronym correct. The OMOS system, in addition to allowing you to, it's reading as the machine's constantly printing. It's reading the underside of that media and making corrections to adjust to get the printing to the correct length. One of the great features of the OMOS system that's built into the platen on the machine is that it allows double-sided printing. Okay, so you have a scrim banner, you know, real nice 18-ounce blockout, or I highly recommend a blockout because you're going to print a different image front to back, or some nice Duratex display film, a double-sided display film. You can print an image on the front side and program correctly through your software using a double-sided workflow. It'll print a black bar. That's called an OMOS line, after the print. You go ahead and print an entire roll or a nice section, take it onto your take-up reel, take that take-up reel, move it up into your feed system, reload it, so now your print side that was here is gonna be on the underside of your material. That OMOS sensor will look for that black line before it prints the B side. Okay, so that having that sensor on the underside of your media allows them to print a line on the top side of your media, which then gets flipped in, and it'll find that line before it goes to print the backside. It's a really amazing, for those of you who have not used an automatic double-sided printing feature like that, it's so much better than having to manually register, you know, flip your material down, make marks, all kinds of other things. It allows the double-sided printing process to go phenomenally well. These platen protectors allow you to do that because you're going to be printing on an ink side down against the platen, and this allows your ink to glide across that warm platen area. So, inside the material, I think I touched on it earlier when I was loading this machine. It has edge guards. This is a neat little fix up. The edge guard normally looks like that. It would slide onto your platen over the edge. There we are. There we are. Slides onto the edge of your platen. Something's hanging up here. That might be in the wrong groove. There we go. Slides onto your platen and holds your material down. This is a double wing edge guard. So if you have some material that wants to buckle up, this is used specifically for our traffic to be able to print on traffic material. Has a real kind of thick memory where it wants to ride up. The edge guards will keep that material nice and flat through the print zone. So it reduces the chances of a head strike. Okay, so I talked about a lot of things. I want to show you a couple of quick samples of some things that were printed on the Latex 365. So here's the Duratex Polyfab fabric. Really great. It's a coated fabric. You can see how flimsy it is. I had to use the edge guards to load this material in here. But with that latex ink, the scratch resistance, the flexibility, this is the ink is going to be able to move with it as opposed to like a stiffer UV ink that'll kind of crack and bend. This'll bend and flex just nice with the material. Here's a couple of great examples of a great use of the latex. So this is the Brightline Multi-Grip. Again, this product's designed not to be laminated. It's an anti-slip application to be used on floors. That HP Latex ink gives you a nice scratch resistance. Here's the red tea. It has a, doubt it's going to show up really well, but it has a nice subtle texture to it. Again, that latex ink is able to conform to those dips and valleys of this material, coats it really nice, gives you great image quality. It really, really displays really well on there. Here was that Duratex double-sided display film I was talking about earlier. So these were printed using that OMOS system to allow me to achieve automatic registration double-sided. This then has a, I believe those of you that are going to stay tuned in later for the Brightline Duratex, Wade's going to give a great demonstration of this product and why it's so unique. So, and here's another, something else that the HP Latex does really, really well. Backlit materials printed on the HP Latex. Let's see if I can get my my light to come on. Backlit really, really pops. I hope you guys can see that as well as its displays in real life. The latex ink really just coats the material nice, gives a great kind of trend. If you're printing on translucent vinyl, it comes out really, really nice and shines through when there's light applied through the backside. That's why I was so excited when Ben was able to hook up those Hanley LED lights to my machine. It kind of gives me something to look at while the machine's printing. So, all right, so now we got our nice Grimco logo printed up here, and we are good to go. I think that's about all I had for you guys. We're going to save some time here at the end for some question and answer. I hope Allison and Missy have been able to help you out during the presentation. I want to thank everybody for coming here to my demo center. This demo center is incredible facility. It allows us to bring in customers one-on-one, spend many hours kicking the tires on a machine, seeing all the features and benefits that the machine has to offer, letting them see it in real time and see the applications they want to use. I'm staffed here full time and always available to do anything. We can log on via a personalized webinar, set it up via camera, show some things. It allows us to print specific samples. Grimco has a phenomenal library of samples for all the different medias that we print. But say you got some unique product that you want to see. Hey, I want to see this print on this machine with this software. We're able to do so many permutations of that that setup to make sure that the equipment you purchase is going to be the right decision for you. Additionally, it's a really neat opportunity we have here to conduct training, whether it's training with a customer, showing them, giving them an update, showing them a new feature on a machine they may not be aware of, or training of our own sales staff. We've conducted many, many training sessions with the different sales entities who may not be familiar with a certain product line, want to gain a little more experience in that area. It's a really great opportunity we have here in this demo center, and it's a testament to what Grimco is willing to do to make sure they're supplying their customers with that amazing experience, any of the products they're looking into getting. So I want to thank everybody for showing up this morning and watching this webinar. I hope it's been informative. I'm going to throw it back to Allison and Missy and see what else we can do.
Sounds great. Thanks, Neil. So we're going to go ahead and open it up to Missy. And also, if you haven't already put in, there's been quite a few questions coming through, but if you haven't already, please go ahead and type your questions in either the chat or the Q&A section below. Missy, are you on?
I am. Can you hear me?
We can hear you great.
Great. Okay, Neil, first of all, great job. I know it's very difficult to stand there and talk and demo and not have much interaction. So you did an awesome job.
Thank you, Missy.
Yeah, sure. Great questions coming in, and I'm very grateful that I can type quickly because it was hard to keep up with everything. There were a few questions that were a little more intricate that I'm just going to address quickly. Ricardo had asked about the difference between latex and solvent. And while Neil touched on it a little bit, I think it's important to realize that it's a very similar process, meaning that with solvent and eco-solvent, your vehicle is the solvent material, you have a pigment, and instead of the ink digging into the coating of the material like it does in solvent and eco-solvent in a latex world, the vehicle is water. And what's happening is, as you go through the curing chamber, the water is evaporating off, and that's where you're getting your durability and scratch resistance. So you also have the added bonus of not having to wait to outgas, right? You can go direct to lamination. And likewise, you don't have to worry about the smell that comes with eco solvent and solvent. The great news is that you're not losing out on durability or scratch resistance. In fact, we have hard solvent scratch resistance on self-adhesive vinyl and on banner. So it's a very different process, but you're not losing anything by not, you know, using an eco solvent. The other great thing is that you can print on things that are uncoated. So things like, you know, fabrics, things like, you know, bond material, you know, like 20-pound bond paper, right? You could print on uncoated materials and not have to worry about losing the image quality. So, and hopefully that kind of, I know it's a high level overview, but it's, there are many, many differences, but certainly latex always comes out on top there. Daryl asked about print heads, and I think he mentioned that something about a Mamaki dealer told him that he'd be paying, you know, thousands of dollars every year in print heads. So one of the other differences between solvent and eco-solvent and latex is the fact that, you know, we are print heads, we consider them a consumable. So you have three consumables on latex. You have your print head, you have your ink, and you have your cleaning cartridge or your maintenance cartridge, right? And so that's it. I mean, that's your consumables. So when we talk about a cost per square foot, you know, we're including all three of those consumables in that number. So, and we are very, you know, comparable to eco-solvent and solvent, and most times we're better from a cost per square foot perspective. So it's not like we're, you know, pulling the wool over your eyes and saying, you know, giving you these hidden costs. You know, the printheads themselves are not expensive at all. And on top of it, the benefit is, you know, you're not, on an eco-solvent head, it degrades over a lifetime of you know, however long it lasts, you know, a year, maybe 2 years. But what you have to realize is when you change a print head on a latex, you're getting a brand new print head, right? You're getting all new nozzles. You're getting, everything's brand new. Okay. So think about that. Think about being able to start from, you know, a very high, you know, IQ several times, you know, throughout the life of the printer. So it is actually a benefit to be able to replace the print head and replace the print head yourself without having to call a technician. You know, I think about this current environment we're in, and you think about a print shop that may be down because they can't get their head replaced because they can't get a technician to come out and do it for them. You know, that's you, it takes about 2, maybe 3 minutes to change a head on a latex. So, sorry, I wrote down a bunch of these. I had a lot of specific questions about people who are looking to use certain materials, maybe not traditional materials. Neil, I tuned out while I was answering some of these questions, and I don't know if you showed the media locator tool or.
Yeah, so I showed the front panel for the media locator. It's all of those substrates are also available in the PrintOS system, so you can download them to the rip as opposed to from your printer first. But it multiple options available to pull thousands of preset profiles.
Yeah, so we have and that's true. You can just pull them down from the front panel, but we also have that. We have a Latex Knowledge Center, and we have a media locator tool, which will allow you to go in and say, you know, I want to print on a thicker poster paper, right? And you can just select the material, and it'll provide a slew of manufacturers as well as provide the recommended settings for those materials. So the joy of latex is that, you know, there's not much you can't put through this machine. I mean, there are limitations certainly, but, you know, I've tried just about everything, I think, at this point. Neil alluded to the fact that I do have a latex printer in my house. He is correct. It is not in my living room. However, it is in my dining room. So that's okay. But my point is, you know, I, even while we're kind of in this odd time here, I'm able to still, you know, run prints. You know, my kids are here in the house, and, you know, I'm not concerned about the smell. They don't, you know, none of it. So it's, and in fact, we've been able to print some fun things to keep them occupied as well. So I'm looking through. I don't know if there was any other Allison questions that I missed that. So Terry, you asked about, you mentioned that you think that the print he did is, it's, it's slow. Okay, so I'm pretty sure Neil is running that print at a very high image quality, because just like at a trade show, I will over ink things so they look very, very pretty, right? And I'm just being honest. However, I can tell you this confidently that, you know, a self-adhesive vinyl, he probably ran that at, I'm assuming, 10 pass, Neil, or 12?
I ran it at 8 pass.
Oh, 8 pass, okay.
You know, if I could go cover ahead, this, Missy, that'd be great.
Yeah,
it's true. I mean, it feels like this machine's not, I don't want to say it's not great. It is great for short runs, because the beauty of the system, you got to look at the entire process. It's not just about how long it spends in the printer. It's the fact that the time it's spent in the printer, as soon as it's done printing, I can do what I want to do with it. I can take it. I can laminate it. I can mount it. I don't have to worry about scratching it. You're printing on a solvent machine. You got to let that thing sit before you can go running a squeegee across it, because you're too worried about messing your print up. I get my sticky, oily fingers. I don't want to touch a solvent print when it just finishes, because I know I'm going to ruin the print quality. With the latex machine, even running at a 10 or a 12, I ran some ridiculous 20 passes. It takes some time. It takes the time to print the machine. But you got to look at your overall workflow and the throughput that you're able to put to get done with that machine. So it's not just the printing process. It's the what you're doing with it afterwards. It's the mounting, the laminating, the trimming, whatever you're going to do with that machine. It's done when it's done printing. It is ready to go. Does that help cover it a little bit, Missy? That's the beauty I see of the latex inks.
Yes, that very good. Thank you. Daryl's asking about the two lines of power on a Mamaki. The Mamaki uses 2 110. Okay, so I've been with HP 18 years and been working with latex for 12 of those 18, and that I get that question all the time. So here's what I'll tell you. Our R&D is in Barcelona. Okay, Spain 220 is the standard, and so it is what it is, okay? So everything, it is 2220s. However, this is what you need to know, right? We did, because we get beat up on this by our competition very frequently, you know, we did an analysis that showed, you know, if you're running this printer 5 days a week, 4 hours a day, the increase in your electric bill is incredibly low, okay? It's not like it's drawing a massive amount of power to run the machine, okay? And that's why we have the two separate 220s. Is one is for the curing module and the other one drives the printer, and they're relatively low ampage. There's actually a conversion system out there, a company called Quick 220 made. And so now we don't recommend that for all of our latex printers, but they're, you know, that's actually what I'm using in my house here, is a conversion system. The other thing is that now with our Teslas and electric cars becoming more popular, you know, 220 is much more, you know, it's much easier to get now. Electricians are pretty busy installing those. So it's really not typically not an expensive venture to install an additional 220 if needed. So, and hopefully that addresses it. But I am happy to provide any data you need on the back end as far as, you know, prior to shipping or installation of the printer. We provide a site prep guide, which is very specific about the electrical and the recommended setting. So I'm happy to provide that certainly anytime. Caesar asked about the ink collector and how do you know when to change it? That's a great question. So there is no, and he's talking about, you know, when you have a porous material on the 365, 560, and 570, you can pop out the platen and you can place in there our ink collector. It actually comes with the printer. And so if you have a porous or mesh fabric, something not tightly woven, you can go ahead and print. And then instead of all of that ink, you know, coming through and hitting the platen and making a mess of the platen or the backside of your print, it's kind of absorbed into this ink collector. And so you don't have to worry about that. So Caesar, I can tell you, I have seen some very dirty ink collectors in my day. The printer itself will not tell you to replace it. But for me, it's, you know, if you see that there's ink getting on the backside of the print, then it's time. Other than that, you know, and you can really saturate it. But I don't believe that there may be a recommended amount, and I'd have to look that up for you, but
excuse me, Missy.
Yeah, go ahead.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but every time I print on mine, I immediately take it to a deep sink and just rinse it out. That's the beauty of the latex water-based ink, is you can just rinse it out, goes down there, and that's my standard practice, is rinsing the inkwell collectors out periodically.
So, and Neil, that is not anything we kind of put out there, but I know it's done, so I'll just leave it at that.
You know, I may reevaluate that practice, Missy, and just let it keep collecting in there.
Well, there's a lot of people who do it.
Understood.
Yeah. So, if there's any other questions, any pricing questions, would certainly go to Grimco. You know, they're our largest partner for the low volume latex. And so, you know, we don't sell these printers direct, so they would provide any pricing information for you. The technical questions can also, I mean, they can come to me or to Grimco. They have an amazing staff of technicians. Steve Elliott is their master tech there. He's a genius. And Neil is also pretty darn smart. So they're also a great resource if you have questions about settings or certain materials that you want to print. Allison, are you guys going to provide, you know, if anybody wants my email, I'm sure, you know, I have no problem with you giving that out. If there's any other questions that you think of down the road or after the presentation. So.
Yes, like I said, we've still got the chat open. So if anybody else wants to be reached out to, some of you are asking questions about the price of different things. Just shoot us an email with your email address on the chat and also what country you're in, because this is a US and Canadian call. So we just want to make sure that we put you in connection with the correct information as well as your correct sales rep. So feel free to, if you need any more contact after this, then go ahead and put that in and we'll be happy to connect you to it. But at this time, like I said, Neil and Missy, thank you so much. We appreciate everything that you did. I think this was a great first session. Our next session is going to be at 10:30 Central, and that's going to be on our Brightline and Duratex digital media. Any of the sessions throughout the day, it's actually going to be the same login link that you had for this one, because we're leaving it as one open session. So if there is one that you didn't RSVP for that you're interested in, feel free to jump back on for any of them. It is the exact same link that you did today, but thank you guys so much. We appreciate it. And we'll see you guys back at 10:30 if you're on for the next one. All right.